All right, folks, we're back with the Ting Open. It's game number one in a brand new best of five. It's the loser's match, and unfortunately, the loser will be removed from the tournament. But it's worth noting, everyone at this point has actually earned money. We haven't really talked about the prize pool of the tournament because with the round of 32 and multiple qualifiers, we didn't really have the opportunity to do so. And I actually don't know if the players are aware of this. It's not this round that's won money, it's the next round that's won money. But still, the point is we're getting closer and closer to actual money, so it's worth bringing up the prize pool. $5,000 in total. First place is going to get half of that, $2,500 USD. Second place will get $1,300. Third and fourth place will get $400. And anyone who gets out of the groups today to make it to the round of eight is going to get $100. So, excuse me, I thought we had actually divvied up to the round of 16, but that's my mistake. But still, point is, people who get out today are in the money. Now, if you consider things like, two best of fives per group, maybe three, depending on how your group went. We'll do interest in a sec, sorry. Not to mention the qualifiers. Like, this is a long tournament. But that end game money, that $2,500 for first place is some sweet, sweet cash.
Yes, it is.
At any rate, though, it is in the bottom left side of this loser's match. The red Terran player we just saw him recently. It's Root Gaming's Kel'Azur.
The top right is the blue Protoss. He's liquid mana.
Now, I'm wondering if Mana's going to be able to pull off his tricks. He really didn't seem to be able to do anything. Like, Euthermal had it on lockdown. There was no pylon proxies. There was no aggression. There was no DT usage. Like, Mana just had that game. Euthermal had that game from the get-go.
Yeah, there was one instance of DT, and then the DT did, like, nothing. It was, like, a patient DT that killed, like, a missile turret or something, so... Not really cheesy, but might be mixing it up. It might be because he knew Euthermal was playing pretty safe against Protoss that he didn't want to go for the cheese path, but Kel'Azur might be entirely different. Now, of course, they do play on different servers, so it might be that they don't actually know each other's playstyle too well outside of just, tournaments they might have participated in, maybe if they had studied.
Yeah, this does start off in North America, sorry, I forgot to mention that. So it is, once again, Kel'Azur winning that coin flip for the home field advantage.
Yeah. So he got pretty lucky in this series and the last, but, even still, Snoot ended up winning that series with the disadvantage on the server.
Yeah. By the way, Thaddeus1 in chat says, Bayestria TV, I'm starting to sign up for Ting. How much time do I have to be counted for the tournament? I believe there's no expiry that I've been aware of, at least. So as long as you make sure to use the code down here, bttv.ting.com, or the URL, excuse me. It lets them know that you came from the tournament, it lets them know that you are signing up on behalf of Bayestria TV, and it'll get you the $25 in credit. Any other questions you have, actually, it's worth asking Ting Jesse in chat if he's lurking around, or you just tweet at TingFTW on Twitter. Either way, you'll get an answer pretty promptly from a more official source than Rifkin. But I'm pretty positive you've got plenty of time because the tournament's nowhere close to finish, so just make sure to use the URL when signing up, and you'll be good to go.
Uh-huh. It's pretty awesome that everyone is hopefully not just interested in supporting esports and supporting us, which is cool and all everything, but also actually getting a much better service on their phone. That is the hope.
It's the dream.
Now, we do have Mana going for not just like, a proxy Oracle or a hidden deck shrine, but like a full-on proxy that can get a very important unit to the front line faster. Now, if Kel'Azur had gotten a really great scout, I mean, like, that Reaper went all around town for, like, a very long time, he would have been like, that's a suspicious lack of tech, because I'm not doing anything, and you scouted, I'm not doing anything. But, unfortunately, the Reaper died pretty quickly, didn't see the extra gateways, wouldn't have really seen the timing for a Twilight Council or a Robo in the main base, and he does not have any idea about this.
This is cute, because what Kel'Azur does is so good against what Mana typically does. But this is not conventional by any stretch of the imagination of what Mana is capable of. This is a proxy. I mean, like, the Bust of the Immortals is so classic. You put the sentries there as well. There's not going to be any repairs. This is just going to break them.
That scan saw nothing out of the ordinary. Like, maybe the gateways being chronoed is a little weird, but a scan of the natural would have been so much better just with the lack of probes and lack of gas. So this is his first indication that he's being all in, and he just doesn't have that much.
He just lets him in. He says, it's not... Guardian Shield's going to be huge, by the way. Without Stim, without upgrades, Guardian Shield from these force fields, over the force fields, excuse me, is going to be fantastic. So focus is down the sentries immediately. Guardian Shield gone, but barrier's still here, and the Immortals pop those. First one's going to get picked off. I think he's waiting for the Warp Prism to micro this around. Where is that Warp Prism now coming in? Because Mana is also pretty good with this fancy pickup. He basically makes units have blink with a Warp Prism.
Yeah, and he's going to go ahead and do that right here. I was going to say, the composition of Kelizor is probably the best it would have been against an Immortal-based push. There's so many Marines, and he actually is able to push this back despite having no idea that this was happening. His army just happened to be big enough.
Not without losses, though. I mean, a lot of SCVs died, and this wasn't one base out of mana.
It's not done, is the most important thing. And Kelizor pushing out probably just pushed out a little too far.
Now the Adepts come in, clean up the Marines, gonna push up that ramp. And of course, that War Prism's gonna keep bringing in new rounds of units right at the front lines every single time. Tank is out, but the Immortal has Barrier still on cooldown, so it might not be able to survive. No, it just goes down immediately. Ooh, it actually lives for a second longer. Excuse me, but both players just pick up and dropping right now.
It's not gonna get it, though.
Yeah.
And Mana, he's just so close to being pushed back here, and he has so much production on the wrong side of the map. If Kelizor kills that, I don't think that Mana's gonna be able to macro out of this.
Oh. By the way, update from Jesse. Apparently, there's no expiry at all. Like, you could sign up in a year from now, and people would still know it came from Base Trade TV. So that's cool.
Yeah. Oh.
He cool really wants that tank, too. Though. He really he wants that tank. But you know what? With no Marines to guard that tank is not so important. Trying to repair it up a little bit. Got a little bit of extra health on it. But truth be told, the Adepts say, screw this. I don't need to fight here. I can just go to the natural. No defenses. SCV's exposed. Cancels, though, to actually just keep fighting here in the main. Two Immortals is kind of crab walking around. A little bit awkward. But that's got to be game, right? Like,
yeah, this time, without the Marines, as you put it, covering those tanks, it's not nearly as scary for Mana's army.
He needs
so
a
third
stalker.
Time's the charm.
He needs a stalker to shoot down that medevac so badly. So there we go. More Adepts coming in. GG, well played. Mana is going to take that first game in this best of five. And he does it on his opponent's server, no less.
That's a good point. I always hope that this would go well for you. Back to Europe.
Yeah, swapping back and forth is going to make fetching the replays really fun. I think I'm going to pawn that job off onto you today.
Okay.
But okay, let's get this server swapped up and good to go. Of course, while we're waiting, guys, I don't have like an actual like sponsor shout-out. Just a quick reminder, the Zombie Rub and I are trying to get our Twitter follower account up more recently, and we'd really appreciate it if you're on Twitter. If you're not on Twitter, maybe you sign up and make an account just for us. Aw, love you. But my Twitter is right there, at riff_king. It's really tiny because it's not supposed to be invasive. And put Zombie Rub's up by her name as well, at ZG Gaming. You give either of us a follow Base Trade TV. Either way, it'd be super appreciated across the board. But what is the next map? Oh, Detox.
Detox. I'm not sure if they realize this was a swap server.
Well, hopefully they do. What's kind of interesting out of Detox that I like is I know Mana knows this one. Mana's played quite a few good games on this map, actually. Kelizor may have seen it for the first time when he fought against Snoot. I don't know. Well, Mana's here. Hopefully Kelizor gets the hint when there's nobody over there waiting for him. He also may need a moment. Nope, there he is. Oh, I didn't even realize Kelizor's using our portrait. Go Kelizor. I'm rooting for Kelizor now. Screw you, Mana, you dirty Protoss.
He's using it the entire time.
Yeah, I didn't realize. I don't care if you're one of two Protoss left in the tournament. Get out. Get oot. Kelizor's got the hell it's a boot time portrait, man. By the way, I see people kind of discussing this in chat. I'm not sure where the conversation's at, but I do know we brought a similar topic up not too long ago, where people were asking, can you get like a tourist deal with Ting? And that's kind of what I'm going to be dealing with. So, of course, coming from Canada, we don't have Ting access here, but I've got a SIM card, and I'll be able to use it while in the States for DreamHack Austin. And if you guys are ever planning to go through through America, apparently you can get Ting SIM cards at most Staples/Kroger's, and you can use an Amazon account /card to pay for it, since your foreign credit card probably won't work. So that's kind of cool. Again, really excited to actually try this out. I've had this SIM card sitting on my desk for like a month. But okay, DreamHack Austin, by the way, is like 2 months away at this point. I know Mr. Boris Marikov is getting excited. I am too, but as much as I love and am excited for DreamHack, I'm loving the Ting Open in a game at number two, spawning in the bottom left side of the map. He's on his home server and might just have the map advantage here. It's going to be the blue Protoss, Liquid Mana.
In the top right, as the Red Terran, he's Roots Kelizor.
So, just as a heads up to you, I've put some water on to boil during that last break. I'm probably going to go and make some chicken noodle soup and I'll have to task you with solo casting one match at some point.
Okay. I could do that.
To let everyone know the sacrifice here on me getting better, like, it's me willingly eating a hot liquid, okay? I hate hot liquids.
It's like the oddest thing about you, I gotta say.
Oh, there's like a million things about me that are way more odd than that, but...
No, I think that one is the weirdest one.
Okay, well, thanks. Now I feel more insecure than I did before, so whatever.
You should be proud that it's weird. I think it's interesting if you love weird things.
Yeah, I really don't know what it is. It's not like I've got... Like, there's some people have, like, sensitivity in their teeth. Like, I don't have anything like that. I just really don't like hot liquids.
I fell in a shower when I was, like, 15 or something, and I chipped my tooth, but, like, not, like, visibly. Like, it's in the inside, you know? So if you look really hard, you can see, like, veins where you're not supposed to. And it feels the cold all the time. It's actually super, super annoying. When I go out in winter, and I open my mouth, and it's just, like, a sharp pain.
That sucks.
I know that. I know that feel, kind of. But, anyways, enough about teeth. we have Kello's here doing something a little tricky here, which is pretty cool. Mana, you know, he scouts the front and he's like, well, that seems like a regular wall off. Kello's here even makes sure to completely wall off, by the way. We've seen a couple of people mistake this without the second supply before full wall off. And Mana just assumed that he took a natural. Like, why wouldn't you, right? But he's actually going for a one base build. So that's pretty cool.
Actually, we have been talking specifically on this for some time now, where these one base builds out of Terran players, while perhaps more expected on servers like Korea, even when expected, are still incredibly hard to deal with. So dangerous, so strong, so scary. So this is going to be good to see how Kel'Azur can use it. Now, there's some guy at my door with a huge black box. I may have to BRB to accept the delivery. I didn't order anything, so I don't know what it is.
Ooh, a black box, you say? Must be an alien.
What? No, it's just like... What?
What? Don't worry about it.
Okay, thanks for making that more weird than it needs to be. Now, this guy actually, it's funny. So there's two types of delivery. There's UPS, and then I don't know what this other delivery service is, but the guy, the other one, that's not UPS, he always comes... He looks like he looks like the Doctor Who guy. No, it's not FedEx. Like, he's just, like, in a red nameless van. The most recent one, the old doctor. I kind of want to put my webcam on to show you guys, but I think it'd be look weird if I hold that up to the window at the front door.
You know what's so annoying about America? We have the USPS and UPS. It took me a very long time when I was younger to get the difference.
Isn't USPS your standard postal service?
United States Postal Service. Yep.
All right. So drop for drop. Going to be a little bit awkward passing each other here.
Yeah, you know, Mono was doing his own aggressive build, you know, not really a lot of tech, just that Warpers and an Observer, so this is going to be a little funny.
Yo, if he's going for the pylon, he can depower the gateway, but he's going for kills instead, which isn't a terrible choice.
Scan the Observer, too. Well, I don't know, like, one of mine might not be worth it, but we'll see. The Mothership Core is going to go down here. The Hellions are going to be killed. One of them is. Back off of that main.
One of mine's going to zone out the Stalkers, though. One's going to have to die. Oh, wait, no, here comes the Observer.
But this is the first time I've seen this ramp actually being used, so that you can see how it doesn't benefit the defender for once.
Yeah. This robo being so out of place too is quite awkward. Meanwhile, on the other side of the map, we did have the counter attack drops and Warprins begins. So Mana not panicking too much at home, says aggression and, you know, offense is the best defense and whatnot.
Loses a sentry. It was kind of odd to see a sentry in there to begin with.
Uh-oh. Commanding the Marines. I'm not sure what happened here, but some control mistakes out of Kel'Azur while he was busy defending on the other side of the map.
Oh, go Viking. I think Kel'Azur is taking a lot more damage, though. In fact, I'm sure of it, with the SCV count being what it is. The medevac still being alive means that there was the potential to do more, but all detox, not enough space to this very little ledge here. It's kind of deceiving. Liberator comes in and denies natural mining, but it's not mining that much anyway.
No Mothership Core to photon overcharge the pylon, but I think he realizes he can't really stick around here for too long either. And Kel'Azur, unfortunately, is really behind at this point. 11 SCVs to work with on one base. Tries to get a second command center. It's finishing soon-ish. But this is going to be hard recovery. If he had like 3 CCs, you're like, okay, losing SCVs isn't so bad. You at least get the third mule, but even this is going to be tough.
Yeah.
Now, funny enough, what he has is actually great for defending against this attack on the way, right? Like, there's going to be the Cyclone, there's going to be the tank. He really shouldn't take too much damage from Mana's Stalker fight.
Yeah, exactly. This is a very good, just like set it and forget it type of defense, where you all have to do is set it in one position and these units will do well. But of course, he knows that a war prism could be made again, and as such, doesn't want to spread his army out too much. Unfortunately, with so much dead space in your main on this map, that one Widow Mine trying to take care of a war prism is not going to happen. So whenever Mana does make another one, you should be able to get a lot of damage done. Now, breaking down the wall is something that Mana really wasn't supposed to be able to get. These units, you know, if they were in position, they would have just backed them off immediately. And they get a Liberator, too. Oh, no. People, Fear Dragons remind me about the water. Other people are saying they're in the box. That's a little creepy.
No, it's like a 4 foot tall box outside on my front step. I don't know what that is. I'm really, really curious.
Well, Advark Pepper says that he's cold inside of the box.
Oh, well, if he's got Wi-Fi in it, that's impressive. Because God knows I don't get cell service around here. If you guys don't know, I actually get a discount. Like, my phone bill, which is $70, is sadly the discounted version of it because cell service in my area is so bad. They're like, yeah, we'll give you guys like 20% off a month because you basically can't use your phones anywhere at home. Actually, if I were to call anyone here on my phone, I would have to walk out to the end of the driveway to do it. It's pretty stupid. It's pretty ridiculous. It works great when I'm in the city, but being in the country sucks balls. Mm. Now, as the game does continue on, funny enough, like, you know, Kelizer's show you guys the income graph before I do this. It's gonna be all blue. Yeah, he's been so far behind, and he's been trying to play from behind. Now, the cool thing is Terran has got a really, I think it's the most comeback potential race. But I can't see him taking a great fight, no matter how this plays out. Mana doesn't have Blink yet, but he will in a moment. Getting on top of those tanks is going to be relatively easy. The Cyclone's not going to be able to do any kiting. And there's like one tank waiting to maybe pick up some probes on the other side of the field, if that.
Right. I mean, their comeback potential comes from their ability to drop. Well, and mules. but there's not really a drop that's going to do a lot of damage on Kelizer. It simply doesn't have enough units. He has very important units that are good at defending if they're not pounced upon. Those are called tanks, but they're actually also not very good at defending multiple locations. So Mana just takes advantage of the map here, gets combat shields. Not going to get stim probably, but it's so far off from finishing. Might not even matter. In fact, probably won't matter. Yeah, that might just be game there. Nicely played from Mana. I mean, he got that early lead with his drop doing more than Kelizer's drop. And that kind of just tumbled forward there. I think the map had a little bit to do with it too. But I don't know. It was a bold choice from both of them to do aggressive maneuvers.
Yeah.
Mana just got better.
Well, Mana now sitting here with a 2-0 lead. Let's go back to North America. Give Kelizer a bit of love.
Mm-hmm. The next map is going to be Lairlak. I'm getting this spinny bug again, so now I have to manually search every single time. Blizzard, please!
Well, man, you swap servers quick. Jeez, I gotta get over there. I don't know if we shouted it out or not, but thank you more, Bubs, for the resub, by the way, just to cover our bases and be safe as I swap over. And, like, I'll show you guys this. Like, look, this is... Take my camera off for a second. I don't know if you can see it. There's like a huge-ass black box there. I want to know what's inside of it.
See, is it like pure black? Like,
yeah, it's just like pure black with like a red marker on it or something. Looks like a flag.
This is why it sounds weird. Because I've never heard of a pure black box that's not a coffin.
So normally I would be like, yeah, that's a bit weird. But with like a lot of gear and stuff always being... Like my computer case box when I got it like 2 years ago was all black. So.
Oh, really? Huh.
By the way, I see people kind of discussing this in chat. I'm not sure where the conversation's at, but I do know we brought this a similar topic up not too long ago where people were asking, can you get like a tourist deal with Ting? And that's kind of what I'm going to be dealing with. So, of course, coming from Canada, we don't have Ting access here, but I've got a SIM card, and I'll be able to use it while in the States for DreamHack Austin. And if you guys are ever planning to go through through America... Apparently, you can get Ting SIM cards at most Staples/Kroger's, and you can use an Amazon account /card to pay for it, since your foreign credit card probably won't work. So that's kind of cool. Again, really excited to actually try this out. I've had this SIM card sitting on my desk for like a month. But okay, DreamHack Austin, by the way, is like 2 months away at this point. I know Mr. Boris Marikov is getting excited. I am too, but as much as I love and am excited for DreamHack, I'm loving the Ting Open in a game at number two, spawning in the bottom left side of the map. He's on his home server and might just have the map advantage here. It's going to be the blue Protoss, Liquid Mana.
In the top right, as the red Terran, he's Roots Kelozor.
So, just as a heads up to you, I've put some water on to boil during that last break. I'm probably going to go and make some chicken noodle soup, and I'll have to task you with solo casting one match at some point.
Okay. I could do that.
To let everyone know the sacrifice here on me getting better, like, it's me willingly eating a hot liquid, okay? I hate hot liquids.
It's like the oddest thing about you, I gotta say.
Oh, there's like a million things about me that are way more odd than that, but...
No, I think that one is the weirdest one.
Okay, well, thanks. Now I feel more insecure than I did before, so whatever.
You should be proud that it's weird. I think it's interesting if you love weird things.
Yeah, I really don't know what it is. It's not like I've got... Like, there's some people have, like, sensitivity in their teeth. Like, I don't have anything like that. I just really don't like hot liquids.
I fell in a shower when I was, like, 15 or something, and I chipped my tooth, but like not like visibly, like it's in the inside, you know? So if you look really hard, you can see like veins where you're not supposed to. And it feels the cold all the time. It's actually super, super annoying when I go out in winter and I open my mouth and it's just like a sharp pain.
Sucks.
I know that. I know that feel, kind of. But anyways, enough about teeth. we have Kelozor doing something a little tricky here, which is pretty cool. Mana, you know, he scouts the front, and he's like, well, that seems like a regular wall-off. Kelozor even makes sure to completely wall-off, by the way. We've seen a couple of people mistake this without the second supply before a full wall-off. And Mana would just assume that he took a natural. Like, why wouldn't you, right? But he's actually going for a one-base build. So that's pretty cool.
Actually, we have been talking specifically on this for some time now, where these one base builds out of Terran players, while perhaps more expected on servers like Korea, even when expected, are still incredibly hard to deal with. So dangerous, so strong, so scary. So this is going to be good to see how Kelozor can use it. Now, there's some guy at my door with a huge black box. I may have to BRB to accept the delivery. I didn't order anything, so I don't know what it is.
Ooh, a black box, you say? Must be an alien.
What? No, it's just like... What?
What? Don't worry about it.
Okay, thanks for making that more weird than it needs to be. Now, this guy actually, it's funny. So there's two types of delivery. There's UPS, and then I don't know what this other delivery service is, but the guy, the other one, that's not UPS, he always comes... He looks like
FedEx?
He looks like the Doctor Who guy. No, it's not
Which
FedEx.
One?
Like, he's just, like, in a red nameless van. The most recent one, the old doctor. I kind
of
put my webcam on to show you guys, but I think it'd be look weird if I hold that up to the window or to the front door.
You know what's so annoying about America? We have the USPS and UPS. It took me a very long time when I was younger to get the difference.
Isn't USPS your standard postal service?
United States Postal Service. Yep.
All right. So drop for drop. Going to be a little bit awkward passing each other here.
Yeah, you know, Mono was doing his own aggressive build, you know, not really a lot of tech, just that war prison and an observer, so this is
going
to get a little
go
funny.
Yo, if he's going for the pylon, he can depower the gateway, but he's going for kills instead, which isn't a terrible
choice. Scan the observer, too. Well, I don't know, like, one of mine might not be worth it, but we'll see. The Mothership Core is going to go down here. The Hellions are going to be killed. One of them is. Back off of that main.
One of mine's going to zone out the Stalkers, though. One's going to have to die. Oh, wait, no, here comes the observer.
But this is the first time I've seen this ramp actually being used, so that you can see how it doesn't benefit the defender for once.
Yeah. This robo being so out of place too is quite awkward. Meanwhile, on the other side of the map, we did have the counter attack drops and warprins begin. So Mana not panicking too much at home, says aggression and offense is the best defense and whatnot.
Loses a sentry. It was kind of odd to see a sentry in there to begin with.
Uh oh. Just move commanding the Marines. I'm not sure what happened here, but some control mistakes out of Kelozor while he was busy defending on the other side of the map.
Oh, go Viking. I think Kelozor is taking a lot more damage, though. In fact, I'm sure of it, with the SCV count being what it is. The medevac still being alive means that there was the potential to do more, but all detox, not enough space to this very little ledge here. It's kind of deceiving. Liberator comes in and denies natural mining, but it's not mining that much anyway.
No Mothership Core to photon overcharge the pylon, but I think he realizes he can't really stick around here for too long either. And Kelizer, unfortunately, is really behind at this point. 11 SCVs to work with on one base. Tries to get a second command center. It's finishing soon-ish. But this soon-ish. This is going to be hard recovery. If he had like 3 CCs, you're like, okay, losing SCVs isn't so bad. You at least get the third mule, but even this is going to be tough.
Yeah.
Now, funny enough, what he has is actually great for defending against this attack on the way, right? Like, there's going to be the Cyclone, there's going to be the tank. He really shouldn't take too much damage from Mana Stalker fight.
Yeah, exactly. This is a very good, just like, set it and forget it type of defense, where you all have to do is set it in one position, and these units will do well. But, of course, he knows that a War Prism could be made again, and as such doesn't want to spread his army out too much. Unfortunately, with so much dead space in your main on this map, that one Widowmine trying to take care of a War Prism is not going to happen. So whenever Mana does make another one, he should be able to get a lot of damage done. Now, breaking down the wall is something that Mana really wasn't supposed to be able to get. These units, you know, if they were in position, they would have just backed him off immediately. And they get a Liberator, too. Oh, no. People, Fear Dragons remind me about the water. Other people are saying they're in the box. That's a little creepy.
No, it's like a 4-foot tall box outside on my front step. I don't know what that is. I'm really, really curious.
Well, Advark Pepper says that he's cold inside of the box.
Oh, well, if he's got Wi-Fi in it, that's impressive. Because God knows I don't get cell service around here. If you guys don't know, I actually get a discount. Like, my phone bill, which is $70, is sadly the discounted version of it because cell service in my area is so bad. They're like, yeah, we'll give you guys like 20% off a month because you basically can't use your phones anywhere at home. Actually, if I were to call anyone here on my phone, I would have to walk out to the end of the driveway to do it. It's pretty stupid. It's pretty ridiculous. It works great when I'm in the city, but being in the country sucks balls. Mm. Now, as the game does continue on, funny enough, like, you know, Kelizer's show you guys the income graph before I do this, gonna be all blue. Yeah. He's been so far behind and he's been trying to play from behind. Now the cool thing is Terran has got a really, I think it's the most comeback potential race. But I can't see him taking a great fight, no matter how this plays out. Mana doesn't have Blink yet, but he will in a moment. Getting on top of those tanks is going to be relatively easy. The Cyclone's not going to be able to do any kiting. And there's like one tank waiting to maybe pick up some probes on the other side of the field, if that.
Right. I mean, their comeback potential comes from their ability to drop. Well, and mules. but there's not really a drop that's going to do a lot of damage on Kelizer. He simply doesn't have enough units. He has very important units that are good at defending if they're not pounced upon. Those are called tanks, but they're actually also not very good at defending multiple locations. So Mana just takes advantage of the map here, gets combat shields. Not going to get stim probably, but it's so far off from finishing. Might not even matter. In fact, probably won't matter. Yeah, that might just be game there. Nicely played from Mana. I mean, he got that early lead with his drop doing more than Kelizer's drop. And that kind of just tumbled forward there. I think the map had a little bit to do with it too. But I don't know. It was a bold choice from both of them to do aggressive maneuvers.
Yeah.
Mana just got better.
Well, Mana now sitting here with a 2-0 lead. Let's go back to North America. Give Kelizer a bit of love.
Mm-hmm. The next map is going to be Lairlac. I'm getting the spinny bug again, so now I have to manually search every single time. Blizzard, please!
Well, man, you swap servers quick. Jeez, I gotta get over there. I don't know if we shouted it out or not, but thank you more bubs for the resub, by the way, just to cover our bases and be safe as I swap over. And, like, I'll show you guys this. Like, look, this is... Take my camera off for a second. I don't know if you can see it. There's like a huge-ass black box there. I want to know what's inside of it.
See, is it like pure black?
Yeah, it's just like pure black with like a red mark on it or something. Looks like a flag.
This is why it sounds weird. Because I've never heard of a pure black box that's not a coffin.
So normally I would be like, yeah, that's a bit weird. But with like a lot of gear and stuff always being... Like my computer case box when I got it like 2 years ago was all black. So.
Oh, really? Huh. Ready?
Right. Yes, and this is the game I'm gonna ditch you on, possibly, because I want to check out that box, but also get some soup. So, yeah, we'll do intros, and then I'll put the camera on you. So don't put your camera on me. Don't break it, Zombie Grub.
I'll try not to.
Of course, if you guys are just joining us, for whatever reason, this is the loser's match and possibly the deciding game. It is 2-0 for our Protoss player, and if he wins this, then unfortunately Kelzer will be gone for good. So, spawning on the bottom right side, it's going to be Team Liquid's blue Protoss mana.
In the top right, as the red Terran, he's Roots Kelzer. All right,
and camera is on you.
Yeah.
Have fun.
I almost went to his vision. I stopped myself. But alright, Lairlet Crests, last map of the entire group for Kelzer, potentially, which is so odd. After going up 2-0 versus Snoot, maybe we're thinking like, oh my god, another group of 3-0s. Oh my god, Kelzer is now Kelagod. But no, didn't happen. Snoot brought it back in a calm, very calm fashion, as I think experience has given him that type of calm rationale after being down in a best of five. But I don't know if Kelzer is going to be able to bring it back. I mean, he just got, you know, he got reversed. So I don't think it's as bad as getting 3-0'd and then going into a loser's match. But it is not a great feeling thinking that you're on the top of the world and then being sent back down and then being down 0-2 in two different games, you know, like a one base versus a macro build. And you lost both sometimes in your mind. Maybe you just think, oh, I'll do something different next time. And he'll for sure lose against that. But I'm not sure what type of different tactics Kelzer is going to have prepared for this map. Amana has been playing pretty aggressive, shall we say. He got that all-in from the Orbital Shipyard game that was almost pushed back. I think Kelzer thought that game was actually going okay for maybe one or two of those attacks. But then, of course, inevitably did win. And, well, that last game, he went for an aggressive Warp Prism attack. So I held off on his tech. If Kelzer had been able to defend, if he was going for, like, a very greedy build, Mana's the one that would have been in trouble. Kelzer, I think, had two options here. He could have gone for Super Greed and hoped that Mana didn't do something aggressive like that all-in, proxy all-in again, or that he was able to hold off on it with some really clutch defense, or another one-base build. I think any middle of the road, and you're not going to... I don't know, it doesn't feel like that's where Kelzer's going to win. But one-base, I mean, it didn't work out last time. A lot of that had to do with Mana's decision on his own build, to be honest, but... Gonna try it again. We'll see if Mana scouts this, first of all. Like, he has a probe here, and he hasn't actually bothered to scout. You know, he knows where his opponent is, he just doesn't bother to put a probe even in the natural. So, if there is two more Marines here, that probe would definitely not see the lack of a natural, sorry. But the Marine even moves, so he's gonna see no natural. And he is, well, going to go ahead and do that pylon rush that we've seen him do so many times before. Get the second pylon down right before dying. Militia, of course, already here. There's not enough DPS to kill these pylons. And he also happens to scout the build. We have a little topsy-turvy action going on here. And I love this block of the Adept. Oh no, Kelzer is already in trouble. He sends what he has across the map, including an SCV. But there's the wall of the two pylons and a stalker. At least he gets a scout, but that's not what he wanted. He wanted the Hellions to get a bunch of probe kills. His Militia, of course, doing damage as there was just those two Marines. I think there might have been three Marines, but one of them died to the Adepts. And the Militia, of course, can definitely take on two Marines. There's just nothing to kill it right now. A Widowmine's on the way. More Marines. He didn't end up using that reactor because, of course, you know, he just floats an overcharge anyways. And this has gone really, really odd for Kelzer. And this was very minimal, you know, commitment from Mana. Like, the two pylons is something that you usually don't have in your build order anyway, but it's like, not that much, you know? He's following us up with a Stargate, which might not be the best move, as you do know they're going to have some anti-air because the Militia Corps is getting away with a lot. In fact, she dies.
That's a great thing to sit back down to.
Yeah, but I don't know. The Oracle could bypass the anti-air that is available and still do damage, and that's what he's got to be hoping for.
Hey, well, soup's not done, so let's leave that on the stove for now. I see Mana went for the double pylons. Kind of went...
Yes. Didn't actually use them.
Well, I saw the Mothership dies, it came back, so I expected not. Nice Hellion run by on the other side of the map, catches some of these probes off guard, and of course, with the Mothership having gone down, nothing really home to defend. Stalkers will eventually clean up Hellion, sure, but not exactly quickly, and six probes go down for two Hellions, that's not too bad. And he's going to run to the main, try and scout. Yeah. Nope, overcharge denied.
Considering how little he initially got from those Hellions when he felt like he needed it the most, that's actually not so bad. And the game does go back to a little bit more calm down here. So it wasn't for an oracle first. It was for phoenixes. He might get an oracle later on, but okay, I think he was worried about what he was going to do against that liberator, so the phoenixes do make sense. Pylons feel a little bit useless, but there is some really weird action going on because of those pylons. That was a odd engagement from both parties.
I mean, Mana may have lost a couple of probes. The kills are still not on a natural, so that's where the pylons helped out quite a bit, I guess. Just the threat was scary enough to not put this on location, to keep it in the main, safe and sound. Meanwhile, while there are some Phoenix in play, funny enough, the Viking is going to be an interesting dynamic. It's not going to beat out two Phoenix, but it'll be nice to have a little bit of extra anti-air.
Well, Liberator really can't do very much here, so...
He might have been better off just trying to sacrifice it.
Yeah, look how it tries to attack the Phoenix. He's
a
so derpy.
Yeah, it's funny, because like, you see the dynamic of Liberators until you've played like, a team game where you kill like two teammates worth of Mutalisks all in like three volleys. You're like, oh god, Liberators are good. But then like one-on-one, you're like, yeah, these units are garbage.
can't
use them for anything. Kells are still just waiting for the orbital to finish up before he takes his natural. Scary thing is, though, he doesn't really have a lot. Like, there's no walls being set up. There's no bunker down. It's just a Widow Mine. That's all he has to defend his natural right now. And it's going to get picked off by the Observer.
Yep, very easily. Derlino, thanks for the 22-month resub. Woo! We're getting to the action here. Now, this is a fairly sizable Terran army. Snipes the tank right off the bat, though, so that was pretty good. Yeah, and with nothing to shuffle the other tank around, he's going to have to lift his command center again.
He needs to take this base is the problem, though, so this is why he gets so dedicated. He's trying to bait the Stalkers into the tank fire. It's just not quite working out. Viking on hold position, looking to perhaps hit a Phoenix or two. Love SC2. I love SC2. Sub for 20 months. Big shout-outs there. Tank finally gets shuffled to the front lines. It looks like he will start pushing his back. Takes out some of the SCVs with some friendly fire, but that stim looks good, and he cleans up all the Stalkers.
Yeah, I don't think Mono was expecting that stim. but it did finish, and that was a really nice pickup for Kelizer, who needed that after being denied his natural for so long. Now, it didn't devastate Mono, even though losing all of your Blinks, or regular Stalkers, sorry, never helps. The army supply is still fine for him. He's still up in workers, as he should be, and even getting a few more. The Phoenixes are still alive, so this medevac drop is a little bit scary. If they don't kill the medevac too quickly, you should be able to react to it, but still.
Ooh, gets the full energy Phoenix, too. So not too much threat left from these two. Because normally you're like, oh, yeah, they can come in from the backside, pick up the tanks, do a bit of crowd control, but that's not looking to happen here, not too easily at least. Tank's going to be looking for some free shots. Take out the shields on the Adepts right away. That's a lot of Marines with stims still ready to fight. Picks up one of the tanks, but you know what? There's only one Stalker to shoot up. Medevac not in position to save it, but still the Adepts get picked off, and now the Marines can easily topple this Immortal. No barrier. It's on cooldown. Picks it off. Goes down. Mothership Core next. Walks away from the overcharge, and Kelizer takes a great fight. When I sat down, this did not look like such a great game for Mana, and it still doesn't. But plus one, lots of army supply. Kelizer may have taken a long time to get to that natural base. But he's looking to fight, and not go down 3-0.
Oh. It's definitely because of Mana's two overcommittal mistakes there. You know, the first one being all the Stalkers going down, and then he maybe could have recovered from that. But then the second time, in this fight, just pushing out a little bit too much and not expecting the reinforcements from Kelizer has really cost him in this game. His economy lead has definitely gone away as Kelizer is definitely caught up, especially with mules. He's doing fine. You check the graphs, Mana has been winning before that with the command center not being on the low ground, but Kelizer is coming back now.
Yeah, the whole hump of time was just like the command center waiting to go
down. Exactly. But now it's going to start swapping over. I mean, what's funny is that Kelizer is mining out of his main, of course, but he has the option to lift to his third, where, of course, Mana, also mining out of his main, does not have that option.
So people want to know what was in the black box. I don't know. I just brought it inside. I didn't open it. Sorry, I don't have a better answer for that. 8 Marines coming over here towards the third. Might actually be able to get the cancel, funny enough. The army's a bit slow to respond and doesn't have a lot of health if you were to stim in right this second.
Yeah, probably going to be cancel.
Yeah. Not often do you see Marines cancel Nexus, but usually it's the work of Marauders.
Yeah. So, Mana does not know that Kelizer is not on a third base, but I think is a good guess that he's not, considering how this game has played out. His Phoenixes could go over there and check, of course, but is careful. You know, he wants them defending against those drops, and he kind of he's been pushed back twice for pushing out on the map, so maybe a little bit scared to do so. Pushes out now with a Warp Prism, I guess that's what he was waiting for. And Kelizer will have to now be the one on the defensive. But I think defensively, he has even like a better chance than all those attacks he's done. So I don't know about Mana pushing into that. Drop's going to be able to cancel the third base. Now the army's entirely out of position. This Liberator is going to be taken care of. So Lindenai's mining for a little bit.
Still certainly annoying.
Oh, no. Oh, no, 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 no. Don't transfer those probes. Stop transferring those probes. Okay, good.
Third base going to get canceled once again. Oh, no.
Yeah, the Phoenix is, of course, reacted to the Liberator. Not that they would be able to kill the medevac before the Marines would have unloaded, but still, it would have been lower.
Oh, the
and
wall
was
going to
go for the attack.
The Adepts get on top of the tanks immediately. SCVs get pre-pulled into this. Those tanks are going to be able to fire at the Stalkers at the backside. Warpers and Micro on top of the Immortals. You know what? Kelizer looked like he had this game in the bag, but this is a pretty good fight out of Mana, although it does look like Kelizer's still going to take the fight, but at a cost of 26 SCVs.
No Micro on the Immortals besides what brought him to the front lines. With Marauders and tanks left, that's where Immortals do their best. More Marines coming forward. However, they do have Sim, and he's going to have to back off once he loses his entire army.
Cleans up the natural while this goes on.
Yeah, he actually pulled the probes. When he lost 10, not comparable to Kelizer's 27, but he's not mining off of it. Of course, that third base never got to finish. Kelizer had a third base finishing up right now. It's kind of like a secret one. Mana never bothered checking for it. This game is awfully odd, but I think the army of Kelizer... Ooh. Oh, no. Well,
yeah, Kelizer, if he hadn't been able to drive off mining from the natural base and deny that entirely while this was going on, Mana would still have warp-ins, you know, with that huge probe lead. But the funny thing is, while both players' income is kind of in the garbage, Mana's is slightly less in the garbage, but Kelizer is still not in a great spot. Like, to go for an attack right now would probably be his best bet, and would probably get some pretty good damage. I don't think the Mothership Core got replaced again, so there's no Photon Overcharge threat. It's just Adepts and Sentries, and this is where that plus one on the Marines is really going to be nice.
I don't know how Mana's going to hold off this push. He sees the third base, too, and that's just not a good feeling.
No.
Mana, if he had been able to either have the economy mining on his natural or the third base up and running, I'd feel so much better for him.
Oh,
takes
tank.
A fight.
That
I mean, his force field's a little odd-looking.
I mean, nothing here takes the bonus damage from armored, but that's okay because it still gets all the splash damage, takes the shields off of his opponent. Mana just barely doesn't have enough. Medivac's out of juice, though, funny enough. So Kelizer also kind of losing out on everything on the front lines.
Oh, it doesn't matter, though. His economy is going to be so good in a second here. Like, I am surprised Mana was able to take a fight, like, even it out like that, but he still doesn't have the reinforcing capability of Kelizer.
I swear, if Kelizer doesn't put down one more depot, I'm going to...
Yeah. I feel like that was originally on purpose. Like he was hoping non-Blinkstalkers.
Things would just like funnel into it.
Yeah, exactly, like Zerg, but that's not what happens with Shades, is it?
Well, the Marines are going to take another decent fight with the Adepts in the middle of the map. I mean, it's worth noting, we've talked about this, right? It was that plus one makes it so that the Adepts are quite a bit better to fight with, but with the armor, I think it does cancel it out.
This was...
GG.
Mana's last hope. There you go. GG.
Kelizer not going to go down 3-0. He comes back with a fight. With a 2-1. But of course, we got to swap servers once more. We got to dance around some things. And I need to go get my soup off the stove. So we don't have a big commercial break coming at you. Just a short one. So stick with us. And we'll see you guys in a few moments as we go back to Europe for Mana's next map. See you soon. All right, folks, we're back. It is game number 4 here in the loser's bracket. And, of course, his life is still on the line. If he loses one game, he's out of the whole tournament. In the bottom left, it's the Red Terran, Root Gaming's Kelizer.
In the top right, as the Blue Protoss, he's Liquid Mana.
And of course, I want to be recusing myself and leaving it to Zombie Grub. So, thank you. And good luck.
Yeah. Okay, so Kelizer is able to bring it back. Now, kind of a wonky game, but a lot of these games have been wonky. On the back and forth, a lot of mistakes from both parties. But I think Mana made the most that game. One too many, for sure. With the overestimates of how good he was doing after that early game attack. That's, he might do again. We have seen it quite often from him versus Terran. In the other parts of this tournament, we've seen him in just constantly pulling those pylons down if he sees an opportunity to. Now, Ruins of Suras, I mean, I guess you can technically do it on any map, but some maps are better than others. He is scouting pretty early. Kelizer did at least 2-1 base builds, and he wants to be on top of it. Looks like he'll be doing another with these two gases. They worked out okay, I suppose. You got 1-1 from him, so continue doing them. Mana goes for a middle-of-the-road type of greed here. Nexus after Gateway. And there is that factory. So the probe's going to be able to see this. And is actually going to bypass Kelizer's SCV. Kelizer a little less important on the scouting. Although, like, you know, you always want to see if someone's one-basing you, too. But it's going to be able to see nothing out of the ordinary. If it's kept hidden, it might be able to see what tech is chosen. Now, the reason you would want to deny this is not just because, you know, that you don't want them to know what they're doing, which is always a nice feeling to have in StarCraft II, having your opponent in the dark. It's also so that by the time they decide, you know, like, what tech structure am I going to go, like, going to throw down, they don't have any information to do it correctly, you know? Like, they want to throw down a robo because in their mind they're going to do, like, a warp prism attack and it's going to go amazing, or they're going to go down a toilet council and then they're going to do an amazing, you know, macro game. But then they get attacked and they really say that, oh man, I wish I had a Stargate, for instance. Phoenix is to pick off a medevac or a liberator, Oracle, a little less important, I suppose, but detection, I guess, too. Or a Void Ray in some instances as well. We've seen a couple of attacks from the likes of Reality and even Journey, once or twice, I believe, that included Cyclones off of one base, where the Void Ray actually ended up being really helpful, believe it or not, because the Cyclone would try and attack and would just go down super quick. Done correctly, the Cyclone should never die, but it happens. It's where Patience tried to figure out how to deal with one base all-ins, and he still hasn't really figured out the magic. But it is a Stargate opener, so I just played, I just hyped up the Stargate a lot. It is a very good catch-all against one base openers. But this is going to be the kind of standard, I think the most common one that we see. Marines, a Widowmon in the front, Hellions in the natural. Ideally, you just have to worry about the natural at all. You pull the probes, you have like a wall off of some type on the main, and then you only have to deal with the main attack. But Mana never got that scouting, so this is where it's also really important. He has a good tech structure to take care of this. You know, pick up the Widow Mine, kill the medevac, but he does not have a good overall setup for it. This Oracle actually looks a little odd, just kind of keeping around here. I guess this probe got in far enough to see that it wasn't a command center on the low ground, and that might have given him a little bit of an alert, but there are so many variations of a one-base build. This probe seeing the Hellions gives him more information about what type of build it is, and there, of course, he sees the medevac, but that's where the Phoenix came in. Very nicely done. The Oracle was ready to pop the Revelation 2 on that Widow Mine, so this really was not going to do any damage. This is actually utterly failed. The Kelizer definitely should have just unloaded while he had the chance. Still gonna unload most of his units, though. That was actually a bit of a lucky turn there. Hellions do get into the main base. A full surround, however, means they're not gonna get too many probe kills. Very nicely done on those probes. Only two going down. And this one base attack, well, it didn't work. Two probes. Four probes in total. Okay, there we go. And an entire medevac and Hellions for it? That's not worth it. That's not an even trade. Kelizer is not following up with like one base build, though. We do see some people on ruins in different spawn locations, usually vertical, but sometimes horizontal. Just stay on one base, you know, they get stim, they get tanks, they do a push, and it looks quite scary. Kelizer went for the command center, which is going to be something that these Phoenixes can scout as they head on over here. Yeah, Twilight Council Forge go down now that Mana's sure he's dealt with everything fine and dandy. Like, he actually knows in it how good a position he's in here. I really like these pylons, of course. Liberator follow-ups are very common with one-base builds, and actually there it is right there. And that has been what Kelizer has done in the past games. He's done a one-base build, so very nice positioning. The Phoenix is going on top of a medevac, not quite going to kill it, but the Adept's going to get into the natural. They're going to maybe go on top of a Widowmine accidentally. That's... Nope, they just run past it. Bye-bye, mule. The Liberator is just at a range of that pylon. Oh, that's annoying. That's super annoying. but the Adepts are denying mining themselves, so kind of even stakes here. They're not going to get into that main base. There's so few units, and the medevac's going to go down now, too. Oh, just barely not. Just kidding. Yeah, definitely repair that if you can. Oh, very nice decision by Kelizer to do that. So this is like... The alien is right outside your door, but the door's holding, so you feel okay, but not great. It's gotta be what Kelizer's feeling right now, as he does want that natural to be up in mining, but it's just not gonna happen. Not right now, anyways. Looks like Liberator was finally cleaned up by a Phoenix. He just made one back at home and took care of it. We got a Cyclone, another Liberator on the way, just any units he can create. See, looks like he let the door open, though. The supply depots were lowered, and the Adepts got in. Check out firing the Phoenix first, not a bad idea, as they do protect the medevac. Grabs the Cyclone, want to focus this Phoenix down if he can, but the Adepts have been cleaned up, so either way, He's okay. Looks like more depth gone to the natural, though. Shit it over. And that has been some good damage from Mana, who is, man, almost double the workers of Kel'Azur. Almost getting the Cyclone. There we go. The Adepts do finally die. That took a long time. That was a lot of use out of just a few Adepts and a few Phoenix. Very nicely done from Mana. Kel'Azur is in kind of a tricky spot here. Doesn't have a lot of units, even though he's starting to get tech. He's starting to get, you know, he could get medevacs right now, too. He is not going to have Sim, so he's not going to have combat shields. And he really doesn't have that many units to drop with anyways. Like, he might have the medevacs, but he won't have the units to actually threaten Mana. Mana's going for a third base. He knows he's in a great position. He's got plus one Resonant Glaives finished up on the Adepts. And Phoenixes are still patrolling, still scouting to see what the army looks like of Kel'Azur. And, you know, this is actually really important scouting. Otherwise, he might be more hesitant to push in with Adepts, but seeing how small it is, this is awkward for Kel'Azur, actually. that's unfortunate for him. But he sees how small the Marine Army is, so he knows that he can shade in the Adepts and probably take a good fight. That's a lot of information to get from these Phoenixes. He also sees the production at home. He knows how light those barracks were and how many units there are. Just a single Cyclone right now. Waiting in that main base. Mana did say that he had to, was probably going to have to pause in the last game, but I guess it was fast enough that it didn't, so this is probably that pause he was talking about. It's so odd looking. He's about to attack and he's the one that pauses.
I'm back. Hopefully the slurping wasn't too distracting and gross for you. I tried to do it off mic as much as I could.
I didn't really notice.
Okay, good. Kick-ass solo cast in this time group. Do you want to finish the game solo, or, I mean...
Not particularly.
I didn't think so. Okay, cool.
I actually feel like my throat is strange, but it's not, like, affecting, like, me painfully yet, you know?
Right, like, it feels like you sound different, but you know you don't. I hate that.
Yeah.
That's kind of why I had to go get some soup. Don't you get sick on me, man. Only one of us is allowed to be sick at a time, okay?
Okay, I'll try.
All right, well, I got the camera back, too, so means we'll see how this fight goes down. Because I've been sitting here watching the whole time, and without you did remake a Cyclone, which is great, but without that first one, this is going to be rough and tough no matter how this plays out. The SCV count has recovered to a kind of decent amount, thanks to the way mules help, I guess, bridge the gap. But at the end of the day, that third... this is going to be a little annoying, too. It's in range of the pylon, I think. Maybe?
I don't know. I don't think so.
The south pylon?
It would, like...
I'm pretty sure it's in range of the south pylon.
It would just be just out of range. Maybe.
But, like, you have full energy on the mothership for. Why not try?
Yeah, why not try? I don't know. He's, of course, paying attention a lot to the other side of the map. He's kind of warping in whatever he can over here. The Adepts, not going to shade anything that is a wise decision, but they're going to be caught. Kel'Azur is looking for a better fight here, but no. He is the one without upgrades.
The Cyclone is actually really useful. It does go down once again, so another Cyclone falls for it, but cleans up the Adepts. So a little bit of moment of relief. See how long that lasts, however, because it's three bases versus two right now. And normally when you're the two-base player, you've got an army lead, you've got a push coming, you've got some sort of tech advantage, but none of that here for Kel'Azur. So, again, reminding everybody, is on his last life. If he loses this game, he's out.
Yes, yeah, from the entire group, from the entire tournament. We got so far, and the end didn't even matter. Maybe. He is going to try and bring this game back through drops, and that is a Terran's greatest strength, but unfortunately he needs those Marines back at home to deal with the Phoenixes. He needs them to deal with the Adepts that are running across the map. I mean, Kel'Azur's greatest strength in this game has actually been Mana's greatest weakness, which was his lack of reinforcements. Like, that's the only reason I feel Kel'Azur is in this game still. They've had to come all the way across the map whenever he wanted to reinforce. But if you ever got a War Prism, it'd be game over. It looks like he might not even need it because those Marines are taken away. There's just nothing to deal with this. He lost his natural, losing the third command center, slowly. His drop's got to do quite a bit of damage.
I mean, it doesn't really have the potential to. If the Mothership 4 has got any amount of overcharges, yeah, GG. So a little unfortunate for Kel'Azur, but Mana will fight for his life and stay in it for just one more. As he will advance to the finals of the group, where he will await the loser of Snoot and Euthermal. Now, luckily for us, we don't have to do a lot of dancing around because Snoot and Euthermal are both European. They're both here and should both be good to go here momentarily. They may be watching the stream, depending on how things go. Let's go update the brackets here to show Mana surviving.
Mm-hmm.
To move forward one more. Mana.
Was he on top?
He was, actually. But he was Euthermal who was on the bottom. So that top three doesn't work today, sadly.